Health, I have a letter here that they have voted to appoint Ben Bastinelli to the Drainage Commission. So this is a three-person vote. And if we could have a motion from Mr. Taylor?
I'll make a motion to reappoint Ben Bastinelli to the Drainage Commission.
And I second that motion. We will have a vote to appoint Mr. Bastinelli.
So I guess we have a roll call?
Aye. Aye, okay. And I vote yes.
Thank you.
So that's 2-0 with the Board of Health sending their letter, but they were unable to be here in person this evening. So Mr. Bastinelli has been reappointed to the Drainage Commission. Thanks, Dan.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The next appointment is at 7:15. So does anybody have any announcements that that they would like to read before we move on? I had a couple, if I may. The first one is I'd just like to call attention to everyone who is going to need to fill out the completion of the conflict of interest law and obtain a certificate that you've passed that exam, if you will, and have returned it to the town clerk's office. Second quick announcement is for the month of June, a report from Textile Recycling. The school PTOs received a check from the Textile Recycling that they have turned in June of $283, which then continues to support what they do. We have some meetings going on this week. Tuesday night of this week is the first meeting of the Comcast Contract Negotiations Committee here at Town Hall. On Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock is the Plymouth County Water District Commission meeting in Plymouth. On Wednesday evening here at Town Hall at 7:30, the Town Government Study Committee. And on Thursday in Brockton, the Old Colony Joint Transportation Committee will meet and update towns on projects. Pembroke has got three on here that will be discussed. The first one is the Route 53 signalization at Pleasant Street. It's the project is at 75% design, and it's on track for 2017. The second project in Pembroke is the rehabilitation of Route 36 Center Street from Route 27 to Route 14. It's 75% design plans, will soon be sent to MassDOT. There's an estimated cost of that of over $6 million. And we'll be adding a sidewalk on the west side. And the third one is the resurfacing and related work on Route 53. Apparently there is no funding available right now for this project. But when there is, Old Colony will proceed with that project. So those are some items that are going on this week. Is Mr. Dement here? Not present yet.
Not yet.
Okay. We could move down to action items. Consider a vote to approve the municipal aggregation plan. Do you have some words on that, Mr. Fond?
Well, as per the regulations, we posted the plan on the town's website for a three-week period. That period ended at 5 o'clock today. Comments Anybody that desired to comment on the plan, they do so in person at the town clerk's office or submit written comments to the town administrator's office or by mail to the town administrator's office. As of 5 o'clock today, we have not received any comments regarding the plan.
Is there any issues or comments from the board on this plan?
We was explaining so well at town meeting, we don't have any comments. If there are no comments, then you'll accept the motion. I have a motion, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, I will accept the motion.
Thank you. Move to vote to approve the municipal aggregation plan for the town of Pembroke.
Motion by Dan and seconded by Arthur. Are there any comments or questions from the board? And all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, that's 5-0. Ed, will we be hearing again from the gentleman that came in a while ago and gave us a little talk on this?
Yeah, they actually, you know, were available to come tonight. And I think when we really get into the nuts and bolts of the plan, I'll have the language
right
from one of the property.
The next action item, not to the aggregation plan, would be to approve and take a vote to designate special municipal employee status on the list of departments that we have. Annually, the Pembroke Board of Selectmen votes to bestow this special municipal status to the boards and positions, and we have an attached list that that I can read. You can be considered for this designation if you are in a non-paying position or you hold a part-time position that will allow you to work at another job during normal working hours, or you were not paid by the town for more than 800 working hours. As I say, it's an annual thing that we do. The special municipal employee status will apply to the following boards: the advisory committee, the board of registrars, election workers and town meeting workers, members of the planning board, the planning board assistant, conservation commissioners, conservation commissioner's assistant, herring fisheries commission, the gas and plumbing inspector, alternate gas plumbing inspector, wiring inspector, alternate wiring inspector, assistant wiring inspector, building inspectors, alternate building inspectors, council on aging board of directors, school committee, emergency management personnel, special auxiliary police officers, board of assessors, DPW commissioners, and the zoning board of appeals.
Motion to approve the list as written.
Second.
Motion by Dan to approve the list, seconded by Arthur. Any questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye. Opposed? Hearing none, declare that 5-0. We can take another item on here before 7:15. We have a letter in our packet from John Brown, who is chairman of the Pembroke Republican Town Committee, who is requesting the appointment of Virginia Wandell to the vacant position of registrar. This term will expire June 30th, 2019.
The appointment of Virginia Wandell in vacancy on the board of registrar.
Motion by Arpa.
Second.
Second by Dan. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? And we will add 5-0. We have the minutes of June 27th. What is your pleasure on those?
Does it work? Move the minutes of June 27th, 2016.
Motion by Arthur. Do I have a second? Second by Bill. Any questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? 5-0. That's pretty close to 7:15. Mr. Dement here? How do you do? Would you like to come up front here to
sure.
the podium?
Sure.
Introduce yourself and tell the selectmen why you're here.
Sure. My name is Steve Diamond. I'm a district manager for Trinity Solar. I just moved down to Pembroke from the North Shore in Malden. My fiance is actually originally from the South Shore, she's from Hanover, so I'm new to the area. I've been doing door-to-door direct sales for Trinity Solar for a year and a half. I started back in January last year. I'm the district manager for our office in the South Shore and hoping to work with the community, neighbors around me to help them go solar. So I brought some pamphlets if you want to check out some of our company. We're a family-owned and operated company. We're based out in New Jersey. Our main operations is out of Wareham, Mass.
So could you kind of give us a little bit of information as to just what are you going to do, when are you going to do?
Sure. So I would go door to door probably between the hours of like 10 to before it gets dark. Talk to the homeowners. I'm not trying to sign them up for anything right away. I'm trying to book appointments with them to go back and explain how our no-cost solar program works. Not trying to invade any of my neighbors, not trying to be pushy or anything like that, just trying to explain how our no-cost solar program works. If they're interested, I would come back and explain more and then hopefully help them out by getting no-cost solar panels installed on their roof.
I like that you mentioned that he has satisfied the quarterly requirements, and we forwarded to the chief of police his application for the next step. Any questions?
I have a question.
Yes.
So, in your application, it states that you are seeking to qualify homeowners at the door. What kind of certification or qualifications do you have to qualify homeowners?
So, in terms of qualifications that they would need to get qualified?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, one, they would need enough direct sunlight on their roof, so not a lot of shading. Two, their roof would need to be in good enough condition. They also need a 100-amp breaker box, so I would ask them if they had that. And they also need a decent credit score, so 650 credit score they would need. That we just want to make sure that they wouldn't, because they're buying the electricity off their roof at a cheaper rate than what National Grid is charging. So we just want to make sure that they wouldn't default on the home or something like that. So those are the questions that I ask them at the door if they qualify for it. If they do, if they invite me in, or if not, I set up an appointment to go back and speak with the husband and the wife or both homeowners.
All right, thank you.
Cool.
Any other questions from anyone?
Yeah, just the Reader's Digest version of this is that you're leasing the roof of somebody's house.
It's called a PPA, so it's a little bit different than like a lease. Where lease are paying for the panels over time, this they're just buying the electricity off the roof at a cheaper rate. So yeah, but we are putting on, we own the panels.
Okay, so I have a 20-year arrangement.
Mm-hmm.
And in year 17, I sell the house.
Yep.
What happens to the panel?
So there's a few options. You could either transfer the agreement to the next homeowners. You could also take the panels with you to your next house. You'd have to pay for like reinstallment at the new home. Or there is like a buyout option, which it depreciates in value every year. Oh, yeah.
Are you originally from Malden?
No, I'm originally from Leominster. So, yeah, I met my fiance back when I was living in Waltham, and she's from around here, so we just bought a house on Bird Street in Pembroke, so happy to be around here.
Anybody else with any questions?
Yes, there are several members on this board that have never allowed door-to-door solicitation policies. I've been not a proponent of it, but I've been an opponent of it in the past. And in the past, this board has had the votes to say no to door-to-door solicitation. I'm not sure if that's the case tonight. So I just want the board members to know that since there is a revision on how this board perceives or whether we want to allow door-to-door solicitation for all or disallow it for all, I think that's a policy that the board needs to develop. Mm-hmm. So what I want to do is for those folks that do not allow door-to-door solicitation, I will either vote no or abstain to kill the motion. So that, but with the hope that this board can take it up as a policy so we can have consistent verdict for all that come before us.
I'm one of the ones that don't want the door-to-door solicitation. Nothing against you or your company, nothing against solar. Probably not going to come and thing, you know, the communities and all that. It's just that I don't feel that everyone's paying on people to do anything about it. And, probably people call me and say, well, if you're coming, I don't want to do it. I don't think there's a different way to do that. Telephone call or something.
I mean, for any like no solicitors signs, if people had those in their homes, I don't go to those homes. So.
No, I don't know whether we could make those people put those signs up or whatever either. I don't know whether we should want to put those signs up or whatever. It's just, I think I voted once for solar about a couple years ago. I got my year chewed off, and I don't know how many people invited to go for this one and invited to go for that one. And I think Dan is right, is that we should make a policy that either we allow everybody to do it, or we allow them. It's not fair to some people, and it's not fair to others. It's not a good idea to have a policy. But we're making a policy. I mean, if you want to ask for continuance for a couple of weeks or something, and you can put the time to talk about that, and maybe come up with a policy, or yes or no, you might benefit from finding out that you can't do it.
Okay. Well, on Dan's suggestion about having a policy, I had thought about that a while back when we had some people in, and they did not get our approval. And so I kind of knew from those votes, if I had asked for a policy at that time, I would have got it. But I didn't really want to do it at that time because I felt that there was still a chance that it would be fair. Maybe somebody would get it, but then you get the idea maybe somebody will get it, somebody won't get it, because I've got a problem, which I believe we had at one time. We had an issue. So I think a policy is a good idea. That's what we're here to do, is to make policy for the benefit of the town. So I would entertain that idea.
How do you stop a solicitation from a tree company
or any other kind of business?
say no, you wouldn't say it's okay.
Any other comments from anybody?
I take these door-to-door comments seriously, but I take them one at a time based on presentation. I would say that, you know, in the past when we have denied permit to a landscaper who was like a member of the board of directors of the Chamber of Commerce, and I thought that was kind of extreme. But I would say based on the Diamond's presentation, the fact that he's got a commitment to the town is listed 171 Short Street. I would move to approve the application on behalf of Trinity Soul for door-to-door solicitations for 7 days a week. The hours of no earlier than 10 a.m. no later than 6 p.m. or dusk. And that it be for a period of 3 months as the trial with the final approval and permit to be issued by the chair.
Okay. Motion by Al, second.
I second.
Second by Matt. Any other questions or comments from the board?
I have one more comment. Please.
Yes.
I believe there's a business for the office of the tribe. It's really better in some cases than tax dollars.
Thank you. Are you ready for a vote? All in favor on Arthur's motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No.
Your Honor.
Aye. 3-2, I rule that...
I'm abstaining.
Oh, you're abstaining. I'm sorry, Dan.
For the reason I said, I am generally supportive of them, or technically supportive. We want this board to have a greater conversation about door-to-door solicitation and market policy.
And so I'd like to correct myself on that. We have 2 votes in favor, 2 votes against, and 1 abstention. So that is a tie, and I'm sorry, but the motion fails.
Before we deny it, I would make an appeal to Dan. I think your idea was good. Set up a policy and how to, but I don't think it's fair to penalize Mr. Diamond. He's got good weather and he's got good opportunity. He's a homeowner at the town and he's obviously a businessman with something on the wall. So I would request that reconsideration vote that would have to come from the prevailing side. So
if I may, tonight I would vote no. I chose to abstain, knowing the motion would fail, to prove the point to this board that I'm open-minded, but I want this board to do its job and set policy for the future.
Bill?
It was suggested to you that you pull back for 2 weeks, allow us to kick this around ourselves, that way you don't go out of here with a denial.
Yeah,
which is what you have, but we can change that if
you come back. Yeah, I'll wait for 2 weeks. I'm also approved to solicit in Marshfield for the time being, but I want to work in the town that I live in. So, 2 weeks.
So we have a motion by Bill to postpone a decision on this matter for 2 weeks. Is there a second?
A second.
Second, but two clarifications. We rescind the previous vote. We did vote.
Yes, you're right.
Reconsideration?
Yeah, reconsideration would have to be moved by Bill and by Bill. And would be seconded by
Bill made the motion. Would Mr. Balto like to change his motion to move to continue for reconsideration?
I'll make a motion to move to reconsider the vote.
motion by Bill, I'll second that. So, any other questions? All in favor of Bill's motion to put this off for 2 weeks? Say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, that's 5-0. So we can talk to you in 2 weeks.
Cool, thank you.
Thank you for coming in.
Well, it's pretty close to 7:30. We have a dog hearing. So I would like to have all the people that are going to testify in this dog hearing, would you please come up front to be sworn in?
Please raise your hand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. This is a hearing. The dog hearing is for the purpose of reviewing a recent police report of an incident concerning Mr. Quill's bulldog mixed breed animal. So you are Mr. Quill?
Yes, sir.
Thank you for coming in. Would you like to tell us about this situation?
I would. I have an American Bulldog. He's on mixed breed. He's supported by the American Bulldog. He's 4 years old. It was an incident. Well, it's not from the beginning. He went through training with a puppy. He did beginner and intermediate training at Banfield Clinic. He went to doggy daycare for maybe like 2 years on and off, maybe once or twice a week, just to be socialized. And I got a license of the service dog. He's been very good. He's always been very good people. He's always lived with dogs, like I said, socialized with dogs. About 6 months ago, roughly, give or take a month or two, there was an incident where I didn't have him on a leash at the time. We saw there was another dog, a little dog. One from my mom's neighborhood, one from Cogger, but it was whoever owns my dog. He bit the dog. We were holding his collar, my girlfriend was, while I was going to get the leash. She was on the leash, he was off the leash. So he did bite the dog. I spoke with the owner, very kindly. They were very unstable. I paid for the vet bill, it was $800. My dog bit the little, it was a little dog. Why? I have no idea. I really don't understand where it came from. It was the first and only time I've ever started an aggression. So, fast forward like 6 months or so. I went fishing, I came back, I was sitting with my neighbor. They had two little kids, 3 and 6 years old. And my other neighbor, well, it's my mom's neighbor now. Was sitting at on my neighbor's lawn. And the dog's playing, my dog's playing, my dog's just playing with two little kids and me, and just kind of sitting on the lawn, not really doing much. But he's on a leash, it's just a long leash, it's a 20-foot leash at the time. And I had, since the incident 6 months ago, I haven't had him off a leash at all, ever. And I've been pretty cautious, but I kind of thought it was a one-time thing. He's played with dogs in between now and then. And so a gentleman was walking down the road. I see him, you know, frequently whenever I'm at my mom's. And he's a beautiful dog, very nice dog. He seemed very well mannered. He came up and they sniffed each other. And for whatever reason, my dog, again, both on leashes, my dog and that dog went at it. I believe my dog was the aggressor, but I wasn't necessarily staring at the two dogs. I was kind of, you know, interacting with the gentleman. I didn't know his name, I didn't know where he's from, I know he was close by. So it was quick, it was very quick. Both bit, or whatever have you, they were connected, except by some, you know, except my dog did bite his dog, I don't know if his dog bit mine, there was a little blood in his ear. But, so I grabbed the leash and I was pulling, and we separated the two, and he's very upset, I mean, I don't blame him. So since then, I've been keeping him home. I haven't been taking him out of the public places like I used to, as Now I know it's a, it wasn't a fluke thing the first time, it was for whatever reason. He was diagnosed like 6 months ago, well, recently, somewhat recently, within the past year, with entropia. It's like an eye issue where his eyelids kind of turn inward. And the vet said maybe it could have been from that. I went to the vet to get his papers and his records and everything. He said maybe it could have been from that because they don't really know. I don't know why it is. They recommended that I take him to training and further training. In the meantime, he's in the fence in the yard. I got an electric fence for him. It's a portable electric fence, not one that's built into the yard, but it's supposed to be effective. And then I'm not going to take him to any public venues. I'm going to have him properly trained again and try to. Good friend of the dog that he's always been. And like I said, he's always lived with dogs. Like I had a dog up until a year and a half ago, and he was one of their best friends. And I have a dog, my sister has a dog, they get along great. You know? I don't know what made him differentiate. I mean, I don't know if he thought the other dog was a threat or if he was protecting his own. I don't know. I don't have a legitimate excuse for it. I wish I had a reason, but the vet said that the best thing to do is just, he said that these things happen. They have dogs and they're not people. And he's always been very good around people, but regardless, until I do the further training, which he has signed up for, I'm going to keep him with, you know, public areas and whatnot. You know, for exercise, keep them in my yard.
Want to have anything to say?
This is my girlfriend, Victoria.
I just wanted to say, first off, that we're both very sorry for the incident that has occurred in the town of Pembroke. We've been more than willing to comply with all the town bylaws and doing all that we can to make sure that this incident doesn't happen ever again. He is a good daughter of, you know, people. He's been around my friend's dogs. We don't know why this has occurred, but we're willing, to do whatever we possibly can to make sure that he doesn't act in this manner or to prevent any incidents from
occurring. Any questions from the board?
Do you probably have fencing around it?
Yes. It has a fenced-in yard, and as well as I got a electric fence. It has a radius, so he has an electric collar and it has a radius. It's just a box. It's not a built-in electric fence where they put an actual wire in. It's wireless, and it'll go anywhere from 60 to 90 feet from the radius of that central box. So if he crosses that line, 10 feet before it'll start to beep, and then he goes past that line, it will shock him. But that's just as an extra precaution, I just want to
fence.
But there is an actual chain link fence and a vinyl fence. Yes. Well, at the time we were at my mom's house and we were just out going for a walk, and I mean, we take them for walks every weekend. We go to Three John State Forest, we go to Plymouth. That day we were walking, we went to the Monroe Street dogs there. Conservation area. Yeah, Tubbs Meadow. I went to Tubbs Meadow with him that day, and we walked around. I was with my guy that lives at the end of my mom's road, and we went down there, walked around, came back, and that's when we were sitting on my mom's neighbor's lawn, and waiting for my girlfriend to come home from work, and that's when the gentleman and his dog were walking by, and that's when that incident occurred. But like I said, we were taking him.
So this took place other than.
Yeah, it's at my mom's home. Here to drive.
Any other questions? Yeah.
Did the journey pull up so last week?
Yeah. Just wanted to see if we're all set with these folks. So thank you. We want to sit down, and we're going to hear from a dog officer, Mr. Hart.
Thank you.
We've had discussions, and the biggest thing I wanted to make sure was where this has been the second occurrence. First occurrence, I don't know if I was in the hospital at the time, but I never even knew about the first occurrence. And I didn't find out about that until we spoke to the woman that the dog was bitten. What I want to make sure is the dog that isn't loose. The dog's not able to get loose again and do the same thing all over. 2 times in 8 months is a lot. Something that we need, that he needs to be a little more aware of his dog and the surroundings. Because ultimately we don't want anybody else right, or the other animals right. So I recommend that the dog is restrained at all times, so he's not to be off leash. If he is, then I'd like to have an order that if he's seen running around the neighborhood loose again, or he attacks another animal, I go pick him up and I hold him until we have a meeting. And you guys decide what you're going to do from that point, because that'll be the third time he'll be bite. And that's my recommendation.
Anybody have any questions for Bill? Yeah. Do we have anyone here who would like to speak in favor of the owner of the dog? Is there anyone else like to speak? Chief of Police is here. I know we have a police report on this. We have it in front of us. We can certainly read what it says. So if you didn't have any comments on this, thanks.
Great. How often is the dog in Jamon's house?
Yeah, I mean, I take him a lot of places with me. I mean, I was taking him a lot more places with me until this incident, but, I mean, it won't be very often now, but, you know, he used to go, if I was doing errands, if I was going pretty much anywhere, I'd come with me just for the ride, and, you know, we'd go for walks quite often, but after this second incident, I mean, very, very, very rarely would we over there, if at all.
I know where you're going to go. And we do have an up-to-date rabies vaccine, which runs out October 10th this year on the dog. But he isn't licensed here in Pembroke, and he's not licensed in Cap.
Yeah, I haven't. I haven't.
So he needs to be. If he's going to be in town, the law reads that whatever town he's going to reside in, he has to be licensed in. So if he's going to spend 70% of his time here, then he's going to be licensed here. Otherwise, you have to license him in Cap.
He was licensed, it expired, and I reapplied for it, but I will do that, and he won't spend, it will be significantly less than 70%.
Sure. Bill?
Yes. I was under the opinion that you lived here in Pembroke.
I live in Carver.
So you live in, that's where you have the chain link fence?
Yes.
That's where you have the dog collar?
Correct.
So I would make a suggestion that you do the same thing here. If you're going to bring the dog here, you do the same thing.
Yeah.
You get some kind of a separate restraint here. If you have it in Carver, you should have it here.
And the electric fence portion of it, I could take it with me. It is portable. I mean, it's like I said, it's a central wireless box. I could bring it and keep them, you know, on a leash as well as have that as a secondary precaution.
You just have to make sure that when you set your perimeter, you set your flags, and you walk the dog and you teach the dog where its borders are. Because
yep.
If you don't, the dog's not going to run right through it, not knowing.
I have the flags and everything came with it to give them a visual for the border, where the edge is. And then after getting acclimated, they'll know, you know, what his border is.
That's what all the fence companies do, is they put the fence, they put out the flag, and they walk the dog up and get it to beep. And they'll actually walk the dog into it so that the dog realizes, and once it goes past that flag, it's going to take the head.
A little on the recommendation, that if he does come here,
mm-hmm.
he has, you know, anything else that the dog does,
break the barrier or whatever, or you don't have to go home and fight somebody or another, you know,
That's what I want.
And they get licensed.
Yes.
Any other questions for Bill?
Bill, I can answer two of my questions before here.
I can see it right there.
Well, I think we agree with your assessment, and apparently the gentleman here seems to be willing to do what you're suggesting, but we'll have to see how all that works out. So we have a motion.
The same type of restrictions here.
Main thing is safety. You know, for anybody around you. And for the dog.
It's not only my dog.
If you make mistakes and the dog fails, it's not the dog's fault for failing.
Of course, And I don't want to see another dog get hurt. I mean, the dogs that got bit, both of them, very. I mean, I know one of the first one, the second one. I mean, I've seen him a lot.
The first one was a shih tzu.
Yeah, and it's my mom's neighbor that I know pretty well, and you know, it was very. I mean, she was very, you know, nice about it at the time. But I didn't know this dog very well, but I know he's a very well mannered, very nice dog. I mean, I don't want to see another. You know, I don't want to see anything bad happen to anybody's dog, mine or any other dog. Yeah. He was on a leash this second incident. Absolutely, 100%. It was a long leash, but it was a leash. I heard that somewhere in the report that it had been stated it was no leash. It was absolutely a leash the second time. First time, we were holding the collar. There was no leash. I'll be happy to say that. Second time, absolutely 100%. It was a 20-foot leash. It was a long leash, and I was holding half of it. But
I will tell you that. Mr. Boyle over here, and I've been conversing a lot lately about the beach on Little Sandy.
Yep.
Because we put a sign down that said all dogs must be leashed on the beach.
Yep.
They're leashing them. 8-foot leash. Then they're letting the leash go.
Yeah.
And the dogs are running around on a leash.
Yeah, they're on a leash, but not being held.
But the other part of our bylaws says the dog has to be in your control.
Yeah.
So in other words, when you say something to that dog, the dog comes back and he's right back in your control.
Yeah.
Not still running down the street chasing a dog that just.
Yeah.
I think we have a question from Gary
Fine. I just have a question for Bill, the dog officer. What is your experience on a portable fence the invisible fence, a portable version, when it's actually moved to another location?
It has to be retuned. Or you're going to have to know what your footprint is.
Do you find that I know dogs do very well in their own home with an invisible fence, but when it's moved,
It'll have to be retuned, or you'll have to have it set up so that when he comes from one place to the other, they're both exactly the same.
Do you find the dogs are successful when it's moved? That was really my question.
Most successful is the dog's always on a leash, and he's under his control. The electric fence is a secondary, and it's only as good as if you remember to change the batteries in the collar, or it's plugged in right, or someone didn't forget to turn it on. So the leash is the one that's there 100% of the time, so that's the most important one.
Okay, so we have a motion by Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Dan. Any other questions from the board? All those in favor of Bill's motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, it's unanimous. Well, thank you, Bill. And, Will, I wish you luck with your dog.
Thank you.
When you bring him to Pembroke, just remember what the dog officer says, and it'll be fine.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's 7:45, and we have a Green Harbor dispenser. Request of the Board of Selectmen. to support and sign a letter of non-opposition support for a medical marijuana dispensary.
That was your back.
Mr. Kidback.
Hi, Larry.
Hello. Good evening, sir.
Hi, how are you?
I'm all right, thank you. Welcome back.
Thank you for
inviting me. You were here before, and you gave us a lot of information, 15 or 20 minutes, and we were looking for some additional. You provided that to us, and I'd like to give you the opportunity to take us through some new information that maybe you hadn't spoken to us about before.
Yes, I will. I also wanted to take this opportunity, and I'll give them an opportunity to speak, if that's okay. I know we only have 15 minutes, so we'll try to be as efficient as possible. But I've also brought my Chief Operating Officer, Bob Karp, with me, who's a Massachusetts attorney and expert on medical marijuana law and industry. And I've also brought Ryan Windmill, who is the CEO and chairman of the Windmill Group, who I think you heard me go on quite long about the fact that these guys are probably one of them is probably the strongest security firm in the country, in North America, on public dispensaries, putting the necessary controls to ensure that the community is protected. So I'd like Ryan also to talk a little bit about his methodology and approach. A couple of things, I think it was Matthew who asked me the last time about what does this do for Pembroke? And I think my response was that we entered into a community hosting agreement. I think I gave you folks a draft of that agreement. I look at that as a starting point. I don't know revenue is important to both of us, Green Harbor Dispensary as well as Pembroke. So I think there's an opportunity in lieu of taxes, since we're not for profit, to have the town share our success. There were also jobs. I didn't talk about that, but I think I mentioned the community hosting agreement is that it would be our intent to maybe try to source wherever possible local town people to actually staff our dispensaries and our cultivation sites. So I think that's a benefit for the town. And then I think our general sense is we try to use local contractors and people that are used to the area, used to the codes, used to the also help us build that up. So it's more than just a community hosting agreement. I think the most important thing is the medical benefit to the citizens of Pembroke and surrounding areas and the marijuana offers in the community. And I think Bob Carl is going to talk a lot about that going forward. Since we have a short amount of time, I was hoping that maybe I could give Bob and Ryan an opportunity to address the board. And then if you wanted to open it up for questions and answers, I can go through the presentation, but I assume you guys have spent some time looking it over and understanding it. So is that okay?
Yeah, I have gone through your material.
Okay.
I think that's
the idea. Okay. All right, great. Well, why don't I turn it over to Bob Karp? Bob, why don't you give a little bit of an overview about your background and about some of the other issues we spoke about.
Most people in this business tend to decide based on foot traffic, retail, stairs.
Excuse me, Bob, can you speak up a little bit?
Thank you. Most other dispensaries have been looking for places where there is a lot of traffic. We have a different way of looking. We want to know where we're needed the most. We can provide the most area. Pembroke came up very, very high on our insurance.
Pembroke, unfortunately, has a tremendous amount of cancer. In Massachusetts, it ranks as number 47.
Bob, can you just tell some of the other diseases and psychological conditions that are treated?
You'll find that marijuana now is used to treat PTSD, obviously cancer, AIDS, increases appetite. They now grow strains that can essentially target the ailments. Say, for example, you have colitis, where you have fouls, or strains that are particularly targeted towards the natural get down to the molecular level. You're starting to see people trying to pack different seeds and plants, like Monsanto does with genetic modified seeds. So you're going to see that. You're going to see something. As the science increases, you're going to find a tremendous target, and that will definitely help the people that need it most. It won't be so much as just planting something. There'll be more of a real clinical diagnosis to help people figure out what will provide them with the most good.
Bob, another quick question, if you don't mind me asking Bob questions. What is the current state of, last I heard there are roughly 27,000 medical marijuana cardholders in the state of Massachusetts. There are roughly 150 physicians that have been certified to recommend. You can't prescribe medical marijuana, you can only recommend it. Where do you see those numbers going over the next 2 years?
To extrapolate, look at all the different states that currently have it, you'll find a 2% take rate. With Massachusetts having a population of approximately 6 million, for the next 36 months,
we can't hear you. Jack said that you're not speaking up loud enough, or...
I'm sorry, I'll speak louder. Massachusetts, if you take national averages for acceptance rates, you're going to see that 2% of the population will sign up for medical marijuana within 36 months. Right now it's about 27,000. Massachusetts has over 6 million residents. You'll see within 36 months, 120,000 people signed up as medical marijuana patients, if not more. But that's a very solid number based on some of the other states that have had the programs going for years. So it's still in its infancy. The whole idea is as it grows, it becomes more targeted. More dollars will come to business to hopefully help people figure out how to play genetics and increase their usefulness of different diseases. So we're really at the cost, maybe a quarter of the way there with people who have signed up, mainly because there are just not enough dispensaries right now. There's only 6 that are open. So people don't have a lot of options. Many of these dispensaries sell out within 2 hours of being open. They might be open an hour a day, which is the demand they get for the 27,000 people who have it. Fire out strips with the actual.
Okay, and you want to hold questions and let Ryan have an opportunity to address
the community? Yeah, I'd like to ask, you're planning on a dispensary and a growing facility, or one or the other?
One or the other, if we could find space. The cultivation facility, it makes no sense to pay high rents to grow because it's an enclosed building. It has to be essentially rebuilt to fit in piping and electricity. So ideally a dispensary, but we're looking at all the options that become available in that building.
I'd say with all likelihood, Chairman, that there is probably not a cultivation location in your zone. We're looking at roughly 100,000 square foot of closed building.
So there's just not a lot of footprints in that designated zone for that purpose. So with all likelihood, we would be just looking for a dispensary. Unless we come across or a piece of real estate comes up on the
market,
you know, makes sense.
All of you have this, please, drop by 36 Pine Avenue. Take a look at this building. Take a look at the property I'm dealing with. Christian, have you done that?
Hi, everybody. Thanks, Mr. Chair, for the opportunity. I appreciate it. I'll be brief to say I'm Ryan Wendell. I'm the president and CEO of the Wendell Group based out of Washington, D.C., where Homeland Security Consulting just real quick in terms of introductions, because I want to hopefully get to some of your questions, and I hope some of them are security related. I'm sorry to hear Massachusetts, worked for the governor of Massachusetts, set up a Homeland Security program for the state, then went down to D.C., worked for the Secretary of Homeland Security in Washington. I've been there for 12 years. Our firm has supported several presidential inaugurations, the G8 Summit, the Republican National Convention, worked with Major League Baseball, the NFL on security-related matters. A variety of partners come with DEA as former federal law enforcement drug-related experience. Germane to the industry, we're working in four different states, Nevada, California, Illinois, and Massachusetts, supporting dispensary and cultivation operations in terms of setting up their facilities as well as making sure that they're operating safely in the communities that are hosting them. That being said, I want to cut right to the briefing packets which you have. I've seen across the country a spectrum of people come in, and they're always looking for that flash of light because they hear medical marijuana and they think of the money first, and security is really an afterthought in terms of their process. The reason and point that we're here from a security perspective is for the relationship. And what we've set up is a security program that is proposed to you and this board, as well as the key players within this town, including Chief of Police, Chief of Fire, and the Director of Board of Health. Those would be the big players in our eyes to start with, at least initially. A security program that is, one, based on bedrock best practices and first in class. Two, is collaborative in nature with those key players as well as with the board in terms of setting it up even before operations open a relationship. And three, one is that it's completely transparent. You know, there's an expression we have in our business, the cart before the horse. So many people say, let's get in there, let's open up doors, let's do this, let's drive hard on the business side. Again, they see the flash of light and we're going to make a gazillion dollars. We have a much different, more conservative, I'd call it, approach that's based on DHS, Homeland Security, federal, as well as Department of Justice, and DEA best practices. Real quick, the three-step methodology, and it's in there for your packets, and I won't get into it, is quite straightforward. First and foremost, we start with phase one. It's a risk assessment. Before you even look at opening a door or hiring an employee, we basically say, let's sit down with the town. Let's talk to them. Let's get a baseline understanding. What are the risks within the town, the surrounding area? What do we need to be aware of? And more importantly, the infrastructure within the building. And we, again, utilize a DOD, DHS methodology and create a report that we then share with the town, specifically with the two chiefs as well as the Board of Health. Second, we get into a customized planning solution. In my business, I see so many cookie cutter plans, whether if they're coming out of Washington or they're coming out of a particular state or just a small municipality, where they basically say, here's our plan, everybody's safe, go home and sleep at night, you don't have to worry about it. From our perspective, we start on day one. The reason I stress transparency in a relationship is essentially we customize a plan. So if we're going to be here and we're here for a relationship, we want to have your fingerprints and input and solicit your ideas on how a security plan would work best within your community. And then third, after we've established the baseline in terms of the risk assessment and we understand what those are, customize the plan to the needs of the community and the surrounding area. Then we come in with a full-fledged security system design plan. I brought a few documents which are samples of them. And I'll tell you this, germane to Massachusetts, we're supporting two facilities. One's in Quincy, which is going to open. The process that I just outlined that's in there, it isn't a quick one. When I say we're here, not for the flash in the pan, but for the relationship, it took us over a year and a half. It's 32,000 square feet, two-story building. We worked with the Quincy Police Chief, Quincy Fire, Board of Health. We've had them in. It's not just a one-time touch-the-base conversation at dialogue. We consider them to be partners. At the end of the day, both chiefs respectively submitted letters of endorsement, certifying that, yes, we've gone in there and we've seen a safe operating facility we feel comfortable with, mostly because they're over there on a once-a-week basis. We're proposing that same methodology here again, in conjunction and collaboration with input that we want to get from people who live here, and it matters. Happy to share these. I want to stop there just in the interest of time. Happy to answer any questions. Again, this is a process and a methodology that we've seen work well anywhere, and personally coming from Massachusetts, grown up and raised there, went to Boston College, Suffolk Law School afterwards, and even though I've been in DC for 12 years, I can tell you, having worked with Bob and this outstanding group, again, we're a conservative security firm, I can only share with you the fact that I firmly believe that if we were to be voted on and engaged here, that we'll be bringing those best practice solutions to this town, and not here again for just the flash of the pen, but really here for the relationship. So I thank you for that opportunity to share that with you, and more than happy to answer any questions at all that you may have, sir.
Have you talked to the police chief?
I have not. I apologize. I meant to do it 2 weeks ago. I was on, my wife and I own a second house. I was on the only vacation I've taken in 2 years in Cape Cod with my four-year-old son. So this is my first opportunity to be here.
Might get a chance to speak to him.
I hope so. I would welcome that. I would welcome that. So I'm in the back, so thank you. That would be outstanding. Chief?
Any questions from the board?
Yes, I have a question.
Yes, Matt.
Hi. So I understand you specialize in medical marijuana consulting. Have you ever had any incidents at a facility you attacked, and what was your response to them?
So, great question. We provide, so just to be clear, we're the security advisors. We're not operational. We have security executives. And to answer your question with regards to any incidents, we have not. As a matter of fact, many of the safeguards that we've set up have prevented incidents from happening, like trespassing. We've taken close looks at anti-diversion, and typically it's because we've already had the existing dialogues with various chiefs and municipalities that we're working in, some of the larger places like Las Vegas and Chicago. We haven't had to address any outstanding issues, so no on any responses, and but that doesn't mean the threat isn't there and the likelihood of something bad happening couldn't.
Okay, thank you.
Sure, thanks for the question, it's a good one.
Hey Brian, can I ask a quick question? Can you draw any parallels to other businesses that might be in town that you think a fully functioning, well-secure dispensary would kind of mirror?
Please, yeah. And listen, I don't want to bore you with this, but this is just a sample. When I say risk assessment, we roll up our sleeves. We don't want to throw a piece of paper at you guys. We get into it with pictures and details, and afterwards you guys are welcome to this. This is a report that we issued. This one specifically went to Plymouth. Worked extensively with the chief of police there, who, by the way, is opposed to medical marijuana. We still have a great working relationship. In fact, he gave us some points to make our plans and our risk assessment better. But by the time we're done with the risk assessment, and then here's an example of a security plan that's detailed and customized, and then we get into a security system solution, using a DOD DHS model, we can certify with a statistical analysis that a medical marijuana dispensary, after we put in all the bells and whistles and taken this long process, is the equivalent as safe as being as safe as a jewelry store, a bank, or a CVS pharmacy at the end of the day, because of the measures that we put in. That's our goal here, because, you know, again, so many we see, and I'm not going to name anyone, but you know, it's that flash in the pan, get the doors open, but wait, cart before the horse. Where's the infrastructure? Where's the process? Are you opening something that isn't potentially harmful to the community or not safe to the people who live in it, including the surrounding area?
Places that you mentioned, they carry you off all the time.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And I'll tell you, having done. We've done military installations, FBI skiffs, courthouses, federal buildings. We employ actually a measure or standard that goes far and beyond. Having worked here in Massachusetts with the Department of Public Health, they're looking at the Quincy facility as a best practice model because we use a defense in depth methodology. And I'm not saying your CVS pharmacy or a bank isn't safe, but the countermeasures that we put in there, it's a defense in depth, meaning like a layered of onion. You might get past one measure of device, but you're not sure of the five or six that we have behind there. So, you know, there's no guarantee in this business in terms of security. No one can say, I'm 100% safe. Not even a military installation or airport. But, you know, we do our best to employ the best practices that we've seen at the federal and state level, though, if that makes sense.
Thank you.
Thank you. I really appreciate your time. Oh, please.
I'm sorry. Yeah.
Well, I wanted to expand on Matthew's question. You haven't had any incidents in the other facilities that you've done the plans for. Can you give us kind of a working example of what the facility looks like? You know, you're not walking into 7-Eleven and have, you know, a choice of picking through the aisles. You're dealing with somebody at a counter, I assume, or behind the plate glass window or
Please, yeah, that's a great question. Let me give you a quick picture. So we like to get people, we talk about defense in depth. So what we like to do is create this outside perimeter where even before you step onto the property, we can visually see you coming. And then before you even coming into a dispensary by Massachusetts statute, and again, just the best practice that we've seen in play, there's an initial checkpoint, which is your screening of ID and making sure that the person's actually certified as a patient to be there, either on their own or with a caregiver. And that's verified through a database process system. So like the idea here is, the system, which is run by the state, so that's out of our control, immediately tells you whether that the purpose of the person is valid being there. We have what is essentially called, the state is calling, I don't like this term, but it's called a man trap, and essentially it's a series of blocked doors, so you're not even given access into the dispensary once you're in there. After that, the countermeasures that we employ are multiple camera screenings, both at the point of dispensing, as well as ID recognition when you come in, proximity readers, everything's on the electronic lock. There's a security guard, both checking the ID, as well as one inside the facility itself monitoring it. Then we've got a security director who's full-time at the facility making sure things are normal, as well as perimeter control checks, both inside and outside on a rolling basis, not to be basically too routine so someone could pick up on it. But the idea here is, we're not talking about, you know, the, to give you a bad example, the typical 7-Eleven, which might have a lock on the door and a kind of a blurry camera standing behind the salesperson at the desk. We're using high-resolution cameras, ones that we offer feed to law enforcement on at both the state and local level, as well as reporting devices that put things in storage for up to 90 days. So if there's any suspicion of theft or anti-diversion, we can go back and track that. As a matter of fact, my partner, former DEA, federal law enforcement, especially in charge of New England, he was actually the SAC for New England, we wrote what is a proprietary, and we're quite proud of it, a 14-point anti-diversion plan to basically ensure the safety of customers, patients, as well as the staff, and make sure once inside and people have been verified, nothing moving out. It's a very controlled space, in other words. Does that help paint a little bit of a picture? I'm sorry, I wish I had an easel.
Are you standing in a line, or you're in a, kind of like a phone?
From the operations that we've seen and some of the design layouts, the idea is not to have an overwhelming surge of people. Again, a controlled environment. So nothing where there's 15 people at a counter and a clerk can't see from a security or safety perspective hands that are moving in. There's a protective glass layer as well as a barrier layer. So there's a divide, if you will, a physical divide. And you know, the approach that we would recommend from a security perspective would be this, kind of like a restaurant with a soft opening. Don't flood it with 1,000 people who are starving to eat. Maybe start off very slow with appointment-only scheduling so you get a feel and a practice and a rhythm for it. More importantly, share those findings with law enforcement to basically say, hey, we're going to have 5 people come in, max. We're not going to allow more than that. And that's worked and served our interests very well, if that makes sense. Sorry, I got food on my brain. Restaurant soft opening. I only had a small thing to eat before I came here.
Yeah.
Can you tell us about home delivery?
So, Bob, you can chime in here too, but I can just share with you from a security perspective. It's required by the state. I've seen and surveyed a bunch of different groups that are attempting to do it. I'll be honest with you, this is just my opinion. I think it's a very difficult and challenging service to offer at this time with such a premature industry. Sending drivers, whether they have GPS or credentialed IDs, around in any situation with any small quantity of medical marijuana or cash creates a problem for law enforcement. I don't like it. Personally, this is just me speaking on it. I think if it were to be mandated further here within the community, it's something that we would be recommending that we have extensive conversations with the chief about how to do it, where they're going, what their routes are, what the parameters and security requirements are on the vehicle, how credentialed are our drivers, the background checks that will be done. The list goes on and on. I have seen it work in Colorado, and to be honest with you, the former Secretary of Public Safety, retired FBI, dear friend of mine, ran the Denver field office. He's got mercenaries out there who are armed to the teeth. I will tell you, we do not want to bring that model anywhere near the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. We certainly don't want to bring it here in Pembroke. So my overall response to your question is, I want to tread and recommend a very cautious approach that would be built on one that fits with the model and the input from this town before you even go there.
But to clarify for the public who are viewing now and listening and may read about it tomorrow, no matter how secure the facility is,
there's provision in the state law that provides for home delivery.
There is.
Yeah, but I don't think out of the six dispensaries that are open, anybody's delivering at this point. Because I think, you know, to Ryan's point, I think the more people talk about it, the more they realize the inherent challenges and risks associated with it. And I would say no best practice has emerged. It's very possible that the state could put a moratorium on delivery until somebody figures it out and comes forward with a foolproof plan. But I guess, Daniel, where you may be going with this or thinking about this, it's not like we open up on Monday and we start delivering on Tuesday. I think for all the reasons Ryan has said, I feel the same way as the CEO, that this is just not something that we will do until it's really well
put out. And I'll tell you why I bring it up. Well, for you, the security officer, consultant, really. So I brought it up in this context. But the real reason I bring it up is I've been thoughtfully contemplating this, the pros and cons, reading information on it since the last time you came in. And trying to been gathering information. And that's some information that I got that I'm not sure that the public is aware of. And that's, so I need to just disseminate that information to the public. Because there aren't very many people in the room, but there are people watching and listening to this outcome. And they're very interested. And Pembroke, when the law was voted on, it was voted for 2-1 here in Pembroke for the law to allow medical marijuana dispensaries. So there are people in town that I need to represent on that side, and then there are folks who are definitely opposed to it. So when I make a decision, I need to contemplate everyone's point of view.
As you should.
That's what I'm trying to do.
I just had one thought, and I don't want to keep going on this particular point, but I like that you brought up transportation. My recommendation to a town, if we're going to start this off slow, is let a bigger city try and implement a best practice model that works. But alternatively, a patient can come in with a certified caregiver and get in a controlled environment so that, again, if I were you, and this is just my opinion, you don't want vehicles moving around your town that you're not aware of, that the chief hasn't signed off on. It's just too premature, and I don't mean to sharpshoot the state at an open mic, but that's just my unsolicited opinion. I think it's a little bit too premature for where the industry is and not safe.
We have a right to do that. To make a law that's stricter than what the state puts out.
Oh, I'm not proposing that you make a law or supersede it. I'm just saying don't be the first out of the box to try and implement it. That's just an outside
opinion. No, I wouldn't want to do it anyway. Because I'm looking at all the security that you are offering this place, and the security seems good from what you're talking about. And I understand where you're coming from and your background experience and all that kind of stuff. But, CVS's get robbed and put their own banks and all the rest of the stuff, so it doesn't necessarily mean not. Or anybody that goes there and they pick something up, same as you go to an ATM machine. You go to an ATM machine and they get $100 out of the ATM machine, and 2 minutes later someone was holding them up outside. So, there's a lot of different things that could be considered out of this that doesn't necessarily need to be the most secure facility that there is to do the right thing. God bless the people who have cancer that need something like that. I understand that part of it. But I just, it's a big step for federal to make.
I don't know if you're planning on voting today, but I guess one of the things I would recommend, if there's interest, is to have another meeting, perhaps, where we're not necessarily under any particular time constraints to talk through the issues, maybe a separate meeting with Ryan and I and the chief, both fire and police and Department of Public Health, to get you to a point, because I don't want to rush to judgment here. I want you to feel comfortable with it. As we've been saying, hopefully you've picked up, is that we want to, the clay is not dry. We want to shape a program that works for Pembroke and works for us. And if that requires a couple more meetings to get everybody comfortable or not, we're willing to make that investment, and hopefully you want to.
I would appreciate it, because there's probably a lot more questions that the board may have. I know the police chief is here, I'd like to hear from him, see what his opinion is on
Let me yield the podium, and I'd be glad to get away for a minute and allow the chief to come up. Thanks.
I did wear my suit, and I didn't bring any statistics, so I'm not going to bother with it. I just want to remind the board and people from Green Harbor that, you know, the business B zone where medical marijuana is zoned is also home when we play host to Pembroke Hospital, which is a 120-bed facility for mental illness, drugs, and alcohol abuse. And they also have opened an outpatient clinic in that same zone for the same thing. I bring that up because that's kind of important. That's part of the fabric of what Pembroke is. 2 years ago, we started a grassroots organization called the Pembroke Titans Against Drugs with the mindset of helping young people make good choices. And their vision is the establishment of Pembroke, Mass. As a drug-free community. And I know you're looking at medical marijuana, but the line between recreational marijuana and medical marijuana gets very blurred, especially at the younger age. And we're in its infancy. We're 2 years into this program. And their mission statement is to minimize the existence of local substance abuse issues through education of our entire community's youth while supporting families impacted by drug addiction. Well, I have to tell you, we're just getting ramped up on that. Recent town meeting, the town voted to enact our first school resource officer, which we're working on this summer to get the program together. So we're in really in the infancy stages of helping our kids make good choices. And this is a choice. This is going to be something we're going to be dealing with. And we're trying to prepare them to make the right choices so that it doesn't become abusive and it doesn't become a hindrance. And so we've done that. And again, we don't have a drug awareness program in the school. We don't have a drug resistance program in the school, but we're working on that. And that's coming soon because the town has kind of said that's a need. So we're working on the school resource officer. That was just voted at this town meeting. You know, I have an officer going to the academy in August. We're hoping to have something ramped up in January and actually have an officer in the school to begin that program. In 2014, just a couple of years ago, the town enacted, the voters at town meeting enacted a bylaw to prohibit the consumption of all marijuana in public. They were kind of proactive about it. It didn't get a lot of debate, but it's something that the town felt that they had to do. And then in prior to that, 2010, the voters had a bylaw enacted at town meeting to prohibit the sale of drug paraphernalia. Now that may be a moot point with the dispensary now because laws have changed, and I'm sure that that's something you've probably already looked into. But it's the intent. It's why did they do that? It's the townspeople, you know, and that's what we're here to serve, what's in the best interest of the town. So I know that the application in phase two, which is where you're at now, requires either a letter of non-opposition or a letter of support from the Board of Selectmen. And I just want to bring forth to the Selectmen that, you know, the application serves the need of the Commonwealth regards the location, access, quality, and community safety. That's the burden that they have to prove. But I think based on our past town meetings and based on the things that we're going through, we're still in our infancy stage of inoculating our kids to making good choices and giving them the tools that they need. We're not there yet. We're not there yet at all. And I think the word was premature that we've heard before. I'm not going to even give you my opinion, but I think that's what you have to look at. Where are we with regards to, you know, the missions and things that we've already set out to do, the things the Board of Selectmen and Keith has supported? Where are we with that? And are we at the point where we can take that step and put in a dispensary without hampering or things that way? Are we ready for that? Now, if you want my opinion, I'll give it to you. But if you don't,
I definitely don't want
to. We're not ready. We're not ready. You know, we're just not ready. That's my opinion, and I'd be more than glad to talk about it at length and everything else, and I will not hit you up with statistics and everything else, but I'll just hit you up where I feel that we're at. Thank you. So then I'd be more than glad to, you know, sit down and discuss things and everything else, but, you know, I just look at the where we're going and the movement that's been happening over the last couple of years, where we're moving and we need to, we're behind the eight ball. I mean, most schools I talk to have an officer in every school. They have full-time resource officers. They have they have things for our children to fall back on to make those good choices. We're a little unprepared for that. And I got to be honest with you, I don't like saying it, but we are. We're making headway, we're not there, and we need time to do that. So I think it's premature. Thank you.
Thank you, Marion.
Anybody have any other questions or comments?
I do. This is for Bob, or whoever might be a group on want to discuss it. So you're in here tonight for support and sign a letter of non-opposition for about rate support. That's what you're requesting, but so if this board does not sign that and denies to sign that support letter, do you still have a mechanism to come into Pembroke and pursue opening a dispensary in Pembroke? And the reason I ask it like that, and I'll clarify a little bit, is that like I said earlier that I want to protect the folks that want one here, and I need to think about the folks that don't as well. But I also want to make sure that this board is complying with the state law. So if this board denies signing a letter of non-opposition or even of support, you still have a mechanism to come into town.
Yes.
I know the answer, that's why I asked it.
But I think practically speaking, Daniel, is that, you know, if
you don't want to be here,
yeah, you want to stop. We want to be not necessarily welcomed where you're throwing us a parade, but we want to be in a business community friendly environment. And that means that, you know, the process we're going through, the Green Harbor right now, is a pretty onerous, difficult process. We're on our fourth round of questions. We've probably gotten, 50 questions from our application from DPH. And we're not alone. Everybody's going through this. The tough part starts when we get pre-registration, which is we've been granted a license. Now we have to go through all of the hurdles, both locally and through the state, you know, permitting, approvals, reviews, spot inspections, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I can't imagine that a pragmatic dispensary owner would want to go to a town where they're not supportive, at least to some level of degree of holding up, because otherwise it's just not going to be, it's not going to be, you know, a beneficial, you know, activity, use of their time.
I
don't think, you know, I think most of my competitors probably feel the same.
So, if I follow up, please.
Certainly.
So part of my thought of the non-oppositional support letter is the firm seems like a very well-run group, knowledgeable, resumes that are terrific. Why should the town pick one group to sign a non-opposition letter with and shut the next group out?
Because I'll just say from the standpoint of, I'll put my town resident hat on, is that what I don't want to see as a town resident, two dispensaries barely making ends meet and not meeting their financial commitment to the town. And my sense is, you know, given the population not only of Pembroke, of the surrounding areas, I mean, practically speaking, I don't think it's been justified more than one dispensary. So my sense is that if you told me you had another one in the zone that you were, you know, good to go with and they were pressing ahead, I'd probably say thank you very much and move on. Because I just can't think of it. I don't think we can make it work. Now, contrast that with a Worcester or a Springfield or a Boston or a Cambridge or a Brockton. Yes, they can support more than one dispensary. There's enough population there, enough, you know, patient population there to make it work. Not so here on the South Shore.
Mr. Chairman, I just want the board to know that I have been researching this. I have been contemplating this for the last few weeks. I have a few more questions that these gentlemen answered very well, and I appreciate the police chief's input as well. So I am prepared to decide tonight once the special is complete.
Thank you, Dan. Anybody else have any issues?
Yeah,
think Pam's on the track of, with respect to what the chief has said, and the fact that we've got kind of a double-edged sword. We're looking for other streams of revenue. That has been a standard phrase from the advisory committee and from the boards, that there's not enough money going around, to go around, I should say. And I think we need to look at this as a revenue source that we wouldn't, if they were manufacturers of nitrous oxide, we wouldn't be having this conversation. They would move right in. And I think it's, the medical avenue that intrigues me in terms of the possibility of having it in town. I know most towns have put the facilities in the industrial zone or in the business zone next to the highway if they're that fortunate. But I think we need to look at the potential revenue stream as a way to, fund the resource officer as an example. We just don't have enough money to do all the things we want to do, and this is a way of getting some of that revenue in the town. And I don't want to shut them out just because I have a philosophical disagreement. I wouldn't want my doctor prescribing to me medical marijuana because I wouldn't be interested. But I can't say that, in the best interest of the town, that I'm not interested, because I'm intrigued by it, and I think that there's I don't know what you're looking at for a first year of revenue for the town based on figures that you have, but $10,000 where
I did a calculation. I said, once again, this is a starting point, but over
looking at $35,000.
Yeah, $35,000 the first year. I mean, the value over 5 years, once again, is my starting point. It's $262,000. I mean, once again, I mean, I think from our standpoint, we don't have a problem structuring a community hosting agreement that it ties to our our gross profit. I mean, just that simple. So I mean, if we're successful, you'll share in that. And if there are particular aspects about the proposal I have on the table that you feel could be goosed up or enriched a little bit, I'm more than willing to talk about it. As I said,
$260,000 starting point anyway.
Yeah, over 5 years, yeah.
Well, I can agree with Arthur's position on the fact that this town has got a revenue issue that we're going to be addressing, trying to solve. But after hearing what the chief had to say and some other issues that I have myself from following this in the newspaper, I just don't understand why we've got doctors who are giving people prescriptions with no medical exams and losing their licenses over it. There's too many issues right now that I just don't see the reason why we should be so anxious to jump into this. I really don't. I think what the chief had to say is right on target. We've got problems that we need to deal with. There are plans to deal with them, but they're not in the works currently producing the results that we want. There's a plan, but we haven't implemented the plan yet. So, revenue is an issue, but I see so many problems going on with towns that are trying to jump into this, and people are taking advantage of situations, and it's something that I wouldn't want to see here in the town of Pembroke. And I have stated before, I am not in favor of issuing a letter saying that I'm in favor of doing this. Now, the board's pleasure to make a motion to have a vote on whether to give the letter that you are requesting of us, that's fine with me. I don't really see that putting this off is, you know, really the right answer. It's not the right answer for me, because next week we might have another company coming in here asking us to do the same thing. I think we have to make a statement if we're for or against. So I'll leave it up to the board.
Yeah, I just think too that, you know, I agree with the chief on what he said. And, you know, I have 40 plus years of law enforcement experience myself. I've seen a lot in those years of drug abuse. And Pembroke has a problem with drug abuse. And we're trying to resolve that problem with drug abuse between kids taking needles and putting them around and taking oxycodone and getting illegal prescriptions and doing all of the rest of stuff. But for the board to vote in favor of putting in a drug dispensary in Pembroke, I don't think it's right either, because we're saying that it's okay if you give us $200,000+, then you can go ahead and do that, and we become tired of selling drugs to people. I can't feel in my heart that that's the right thing to do for Pembroke either. And I know that that there are some people out there that need it and want it with medical use. I just don't think it's a good fit for Pembroke itself. And I think maybe down the line somewhere, you know, it's going to come to Pembroke, it's going to come here. I just wouldn't like to see it right now. I think that we have to work on trying to save some of the lives of the kids that are here today. I mean, they're putting Narcan in the police cruisers and fire ambulances. They're giving Narcan to people all around the community, everywhere here, because people are overdosing all of the time. And the people are picking them up, and we've had a lot of deaths around. So it just doesn't appear to me to be the right thing to do for the selectmen to say, okay, go ahead and put the drug dispensary in, because you're only going to use it for medical reasons, for the medical people that need it. It's not going to be that way. It's not going to happen that way. They're going to have people going in with doctors getting a prescription because the guy's got a sore back. He's got a bad leg, or he's got an earache, or he's got something else, and they're going to be given those prescriptions. And all those people are going to come in and get them. And how much are they going to get? And then they're going to say, well, I'm only going to take a certain amount so I can give it out to my friends, or I can sell it to my friends. There's a lot of issues that you really have to look at, and I just don't think tonight's the right time to make a decision and say either yay or nay. I think that we should look at it for a period of time and work with the chief and the fire chief and the medical people or whatever in town and maybe come to some kind of conclusions or whatever. But I would not be in favor of voting in favor for it tonight. I just can't do that.
Yes.
CEO. Now that you talk about jobs coming to Pembroke, how many jobs would you predict would actually come to Pembroke?
It really depends on if it's a dispensary, it's probably somewhere between 8 and 12. Assuming that we are, you know, open at 8 o'clock in the morning, we close at 7 o'clock at night, and we're covering, you know, 6 days a week, possibly 7. So that would be on that side. If it was a cultivation facility, 100,000 square foot cultivation facility, it could be anywhere from 40 to 80 people. Does that sound about right?
Yeah. Actually, the dispensary would be more, because it would be certain shifts with management. So the dispensary probably might have as many as 20 people, depending on the demand, depending where it's physically located.
And how large is the dispensary, right?
Exactly.
So I mean, clearly there's a lot more staff in the cultivation site. Think about what they're doing. But that's it for this. And we'd interview, I mean, we would interview anybody that would apply and post these positions and enable people to come in and apply for them.
Thank you. You say you interview anyone who would apply. Does that imply that you don't need qualifications to work anywhere in facility?
No, I mean, look, I don't have the job descriptions with me, but I'll tell you that the job, I have a pretty high standard having a healthcare background, is that I would like people that have, you know, a healthcare, you know, background. I would love LPNs and RNs and folks like that filling key positions, particularly some of the client-facing positions. But I mean, the other thing that's goes without saying is that there's extensive background checks on the folks you know, apply and ultimately get employed. Not only imposed by us, we have a pretty high standard, but also by the state. So we would just, you know, it's pretty, you know, pretty proven, nailed down process. I would say that people that have security background, people that have worked in ancillary care facilities, nursing homes, hospitals, doctor's offices, people that understand the dynamics between a patient and a provider, those are the kinds of people that we'd be looking towards. And there would be specific job descriptions for each of the positions.
Would you intend on paying people some livable wages, or the industry standard?
That's a good question. I mean, I have my own personal philosophy as the CEO, and I know you're going to hold me to this, but I'll just basically say is that I want to become, I have some operating principles. I want to become the provider of choice, or the employer of choice. I want people to want to come and work at the Green Harbor Dispensary. Why? Because we treat our employees like, you know, people. We pay them at least market, if not above market. And then we also incent them. So there's some kind of incentive bonus at the end of the year for people that, you know, deliver and perform to a high level of standard. I'm the kind of CEO, I don't like to make compensation even an issue with people. I rather talk about the interesting fun stuff, like how we're going to grow the business, how we're going to expand, how we're going to get rave reviews from our clients, and talk less about, gee, you don't pay me enough. And the models that I'm building actually reflect it. I don't have it with me, but I can actually show you on my spreadsheet what we're paying people and or what we're planning on paying people, and it's, I think it would exceed your expectations. This is not a you know, $8 an hour kind of position. I mean, we need to pay a good wage to get a quality individual. That's it.
Fair enough. And what would you do to protect your employees from potential harms of working with so much medical marijuana?
Harms can come a lot of different ways. Harms can come from the kinds of things we've talked about. And I think that the kinds of plan would provide a safe, secure, protected environment. There are other harms with respect to, you know, ventilation,
yeah,
and
so
cross-contamination. Well, I mean, basically the way dispensary is running today, it's on a unit dose basis. So there's not necessarily people behind the window counting flowers, or it's done in a production facility.
Can I add something to that? The people working in the dispensary will not handle any unpackaged flower or cannabis. They get an order from the cultivation facility with a manifest. It goes in, the manager checks, makes sure that everything that they ask for is there and it's barcoded. The employees are not allowed to open it. The state mandates that if you have jars on the counter to show what different strains are, they have to be essentially glued shut. I cannot give you something to feel, something to smell, something to taste. I can show it to you, but I cannot actually hand it to you. When you decide what you're going to order, you're going to get it in a prepackaged, barcoded, RFID tagged package. Our employees are not going to be smelling marijuana in the actual dispensary. In the cultivation facility, there are carbon scrubbers. The fines, if you don't do it right, give me an example. Let's say you flush your water down the storm drain. The EPA will come in, the first fine is $500,000, and each additional fine is $2 million. So there are definitely some safeguards in order to control costs and also to control health.
All right, thank you.
I have a question. Mr. Stone, yes. Through you to the CEO. This
talk about a referendum question for marijuana, possibly as early as the fall barrel. If marijuana becomes decriminalized, legalized, or whatever, what happens to dispensary? What is the plans at that point? Because let's face it, that becomes the bigger issue. Now it's not just medical marijuana. Will he be dispensing marijuana to everybody? Is that part of the plan?
It's not part of my plan right now. I mean, as I tell all the people on my team, we have enough things to worry about between now and opening our first dispensary. And if you're having giddy dreams about legalized marijuana, stop that, because I'm of the opinion it's not going to get approved in November. And I, you know, my sense is that I read a statistic yesterday that said 49% opposed, 46 in favor. That's dramatically different than medical, which was 63.3% in favor, and the rest, opposed. So I don't believe we're going to be there anytime soon. But let me just tell you something related to the law that I think you might find interesting. The way the law is currently written is that you have to be a medical marijuana dispensary in good standing and or have submitted your application by October 1st, 2015 in order to be considered for an adult retail license. You can choose to get that license, you then have to set up a for-profit company, or you can continue to sell medical. The other issue is that the way the law is currently written is that those 70 dispensaries, and I think I mentioned a little bit about this, 14 counties times 5 dispensaries, 70 dispensaries statewide is what the current law says. They're probably going to get a 24 to 36 month head start before the next dispensary is given an adult retail license. So, in answer to your question, medical marijuana dispensaries in good standing will have an option, if they want to invoke that option, to sell retail. But I'll tell you right now, it's not on my plan. We're not going there. We'll cross that bridge when we come to it. But from my standpoint, trying to get something done from this is a startup, I'm trying to get it off the ground.
And I understand that, but the possibility is there. Mm-hmm. And I don't think the referendum's going to pass, because I think that's lesson learned from other communities and everything else. But in the event that it does, the possibility is there for this to be a full-fledged retail marijuana dispensary in Pembroke.
Chair, we have much chief. Medical marijuana is not going to go away, and let me explain why. Even if recreational marijuana is approved, medical will still be there. Why? Because it will be up to 25% tax on recreational. So if you were to go in and buy an ounce of something medical, medicine cannot be taxed in Massachusetts. So let's say it's not taxed, it's going to be 300 an ounce. If there's a 25% surcharge, tax, whatever you want to call it, now you're looking at 375. People are not going to spend the extra 75. They're going to keep their medical cards for $50 a year. Would make more sense than trying to, you know, find recreational at a price that you can afford. Bottom line is, there will be no tax, so people are going to still count on medical marijuana. Recreational obviously will be sold in smaller quantities, but at some point it will come.
But I guess an answer to his question is, are we planning to open up an adult retail dispensary? We have no plans at this point.
Do you have a question?
Yeah. Well, to the chief's point, my brother lives in Denver. And right down the street from his home, there's a facility that sells medical marijuana. And you go right in, you go to the left, there's the medical marijuana. You go in, you go to the right, and there's the recreational marijuana. So that's scary for me. But I guess I want to back up a little bit. Did you mention that you're operating in Quincy today?
No, actually, Ryan is consulting to the Quincy facility.
So there is a Quincy facility that sells medical marijuana?
It doesn't sell yet. It's still growing.
So did you get a nod? Do you know if the company that's trying to open in Quincy got a non-opposition letter from the city council?
They had to.
They have gotten that.
Well, they had to in order to be able to advance through the state process.
Okay, so have they gotten that? Yes, but they're still not open. So if you were to get a non-opposition from the selectmen, if you were to look in your crystal ball, how long would you foresee a medical facility opening up in Pembroke? Is this a couple of years?
6 months to a year.
Yeah, 6 months to a year. I mean, just to understand the process. So we're hoping to get invited to the phase 3. We just have 4 more questions that hopefully we will get answered. Hopefully I'll hear by August 15th, August 15 that I've been invited into phase 3. Phase 3 is the siting profile. At the siting profile, I have to have letters of non-opposition or approval from the towns I want to get in, both dispensary and cultivation, assuming it's four towns, or three towns. You know, there may be a co-located facility with a dispensary. I have to also demonstrate an interest in that property. It could be a lease agreement, it could be a purchase and sale. It could be a letter from the owner saying I'm in active discussions with the Green Harbor Dispensary and that once they get the approval, I'm closing the deal. I also have to provide them with a three-year, four-year discounted cash flow analysis for each of my facilities, as well as a siting diagram of how my facility, you know, kind of an artist's rendering of what the facility will look like. That's kind of what I need for the siting profile, and based on that information, and they go back and validate it with all the towns and all the people and whatever and say, is this real, is this true? At that point in time, they issue a pre-registration, which is essentially you've been granted a license. At that point, you're allowed to execute lease agreements, and assuming that you're not executing lease agreements without a license. You execute your lease agreements, you purchase your business, you then have to apply, you have to, maybe in parallel, you have an architectural and design firm that's actually laying the whole thing out, the site, the facility, the whatever, working with security to kind of build out that whole facility, and then you award bids and either renovate an existing location or build something from the ground up. What comes first? Cultivation. Cultivation right now has to be, you know, a lot more technology, a lot more work, bigger expenditure, but currently the current thinking is from the time you put a seed in the ground to your harvest is somewhere around 4 months. So that's what you have to do, and then once you get to that point, it has to be certified, checked, controlled, validated, that everything you said you were going to do, whatever you're growing, whatever strain you're growing, whatever percentage of CBD or THC is in that, all has to be validated, confirmed, etc., before you are given the opportunity to sell. And assuming at that point there's also been a parallel track with your first dispensary, your second dispensary, your third. So I would say, you know, six to 12 months, but, you know, I'd say at the rate we're going, we could be looking at probably late 2017, have our, you know, first dispensary up and operating. So that's, I used to have a full head of hair when I started.
Can I ask another question to the CEO? Where do you plan on acquiring these seeds?
That's a good question. Maybe you can answer.
The state somehow thinks that they appear out of magic. I cannot go out and buy them anywhere. That's against the law. I cannot bring them in from across state lines. That's a federal offense. So people are getting them through the mail, primarily from any of the Dutch countries, anyone on the Netherlands, Holland. It's literally the only way. You cannot clone a plant in Massachusetts to start it. Everything has to be done through seed. It has to be organic, so everything has to be planted in dirt. There will be no hydroponics. It's currently against the law. So the seeds are going to come from some other country through the mail. Unless you happen to have a supply of 8,000 seeds sitting around that, you know, just decided I want to start a cultivation site.
Okay, thank you.
Well, gentlemen, our agenda calls for the Board of Selectmen to support and sign a letter of non-opposition for a medical marijuana dispensary. So what is your pleasure? Do I have a motion?
I will move that the Board of Selectmen issue a letter of non-opposition.
Motion by Apple, is there a second?
I second.
Second by Matt. Any further discussion required? Hearing none, Alaska. Those in favor to Arthur's motion, please say aye.
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 Those opposed?
No.
No. The vote and declare it lost, 3-2. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, John. Good luck. You have a very, very good presentation. The business model seems great. The team seems great. And I wish you well in the future and in the town.
Thank you.
Thanks.
When our agenda, we're at old business. There's any old business to be brought up. Hearing none, I'll ask for the town administrator's report.
Couple items, Mr. Chairman. I would like the board to declare surplus property. The condenser that's located at the front of the fire station, it has to be removed in order for construction to take place to expand the size of the building.
I'll move the town administrator's recommendation.
Moved by Arthur. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Bill.
Just like to explain that, if you want to hear what it's all about.
I do.
They're trying to expand the Pineapple Firehouse Food Pantry down there. And the back of the building is, there's a big tank in there and a big compressor in there that they used to use to blow the fire horns with. And they need to have that removed in order to fix up the back of the building and possibly put a small addition on the back of the building. Because that would give them more room for putting more food in the back side of the building. It's kind of needed. And they've started off, I think, in the kitchen of their home and made meals and brought them to Brockton. And now they believe that they're feeding somewhere between 200 to 300 people in Pembroke and some of the local communities that are around Pembroke. So I think it's a really good thing, and I offered my help. I was down there and looked at the facility last week, and offered my help to help them do whatever they could down there. It's, a lot of people have donated freezers and things like that to the people. It's mainly for middle-class people that husband broke his leg or whatever, and they can't afford to pay the bills and get their prescriptions and do all the rest of the stuff. So this kind of helps those people out, and it's run very well. I watched the way they did things down there. I suggest that maybe each one of the board members stop by there, and we're going to try to see whatever we can do to help them make it a little bit bigger. Right now, you have to go around the fire trucks that are in there to get to where the food is and stuff, but that's the only place that they had. They'd like to have a nice facility to operate out of, but they're doing just the ground stuff. So so I offered to help organize to get rid of the things that are there. I talked to the fire chief. He said, by all means, the equipment hasn't worked for years. It's an old tank and an old compressor that isn't any good, and we're going to try to get it out of there and junk it away. So that's what it's all about.
So what is it we have to do again then?
Vote to declare it surplus property.
Motion and a second.
We have a motion and a second. Any other questions? All in favor of Arthur's motion?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, that's 5-0.
Mr. Chairman, I want to give the board and the public an update on our current automated trash program. Originally, today would have been the day that we would have gone fully automated. However, we are still delivering the trash toters to residents in town, so that took a little bit longer than anticipated. And also this week, we are actually having two sets of trucks that will be picking up trash. One that will be picking up the automated toters, and another trash truck that will be following on the same day and the same route that will pick up some trash to neighborhoods and residences that don't have toters or, you know, haven't been aware of the new program. So as they say in the restaurant business, this is a soft opening for this program as well. And we'll be doing that throughout this week. Eventually, we anticipated tomorrow, and I think maybe some of the things, some of this may happen tomorrow, but we had ordered an excess amount of toters either second trash toters or recycling toters. And we'll be delivering them from right now to eight staging areas at Pembroke High School parking lot, but we'll be bringing them down to the recycling center there on Hobomock Street where they'll be stored. And Mike Lenny, our landfill manager and recycling center manager, is working with the company to have those things stored on that site. And then also on July the 23rd, which is a Saturday, we will be having Easy Disposal go around the community and pick up at the curb any unwanted trash barrels that people will have. You know, some of them are a little bit older, or maybe they don't think that they'll be needing them anymore. And so rather than require people to go to the recycling center, which they can every Saturday, and take their unused barrels there or unwanted barrels there, we'll be going around on July 23rd, which is a Saturday, and basically pick up any unwanted barrels, and we'll take them to the recycling facility in Avon that we take all our recyclables to anyway. And finally, to explain to the folks that want to keep their own barrels, we have located at the Selectmen's office two sets of stickers that you can put on the top of your existing barrel, something that you may have purchased at Home Depot or any other home convenience store, that you'd be able to put these on your barrels, and they'll be used by the automated system. So these are available at the Selectman's office for anybody that wants to come in, and these are free of charge, and you know, we'll...
That's a very good idea. That's an awesome idea.
All right. And one more thing, the closing date for the 190 Barker Street property, known as the Lagney property, which is going to be purchased for open space, that closing is July 29th.
A question about the stickers for barrels that people may have purchased and they're not going to buy another one. They're going to use their own. Could you mention what the total number of barrels that's allowed to be put out?
Yeah, it's been on the books for years. The residents are allowed 120 gallons worth of recyclables, which are two 64-gallon toters, and 120 gallons of trash, which are two 64-gallon toters. So those are the limits that have been on the books for years, and we are going to strictly enforce that, because the less tonnage that we put in, because it costs us $55 a ton to dispose of trash and almost $30 a ton to get rid of recyclables. So that cost in itself is, you know, close to $1 million a year.
Just one question. Could you explain a little bit about the controversy that's been going on about at town meeting when they said that the extra trash barrel was going to be $46 and now it's 65 or 75 or whatever? Could you explain a little bit about that and why that is the way that it is?
Well, first of all, we purchased 7,000 of them in bulk, and we also purchased them on the state contract. And so it was, you know, that was the cost to the town to purchase 7,000. We are ordering more toters based on the demand for the second toter. And also, you know, we are paying for Easy Disposal to have a maintenance contract with the town, so that if anybody damages their recycling toter or their trash toter, Easy Disposal will come out and on their site and either repair the toter right there on the site or take it back to their facility and have it fixed. So there's some handling costs associated with the town being involved in the toter business.
Okay, thank you.
OK, Okay, the next item on our adjoining agenda is ask the selectmen, does anyone have any issues there? Hearing none, new business. Anyone have any new business? I do. I'm sorry, I
have some new business as well.
Okay, go ahead, please.
Well, Ed and I had a meeting with the chief of police and one of the lieutenants over the activity at Windswept Bogs. As you know, the neighbors have been complaining since the start of the summer season or the swimming season about dogs running loose, alcohol on the beach, and noise at night, you know, as late as 10 o'clock in the evening. And they have pledged to work with us and, you know, get a show of support for the neighborhood. And they have a good plan that will include, you know, ATVs and mountain bikes. So we will have, hopefully, the people that go there, where it's enjoyed by the many and it's kind of screwed up by the few, that it will be the few who get told not to come back. So I'm confident that the chief will get the situation under control.
Arthur, was any new signage put up there?
Yeah, there's new signage. Some of it was stolen the day it was put up, but there is a sign about dogs being kept on leashes, and I believe it says it's open dawn to dusk or something along those lines. A sign, you know, not to bring your car down, and there's a sign pointing to the parking area, which is next to the DPW building. But, you know, as I say, very few will spoil it for the many, and, you know, we're just trying to, you know, weed out the nuisances, and, you know, oddly enough, most of them are coming from out of town. They're not Pembroke residents, so we're a little disturbed by that, but, you know, people are bringing their dogs over. It's not so much to get exercise, but they don't pick up after them either. And somebody who's down with a small child to, you know, enjoy a swim, you know, they're walking through what the neighbor's dog left.
I think that could probably be done because it's, we also have a thing in the town bylaw, it's a willful violation of a town bylaw, which is a fineable offense. So the police officers go down there and happen to catch John Smith down there doing something, to get his name and information and give him a warning that night and let him go or whatever. If they catch him again the second time, they can charge him with willful violation of the town bylaw. So they can be charged. No, brought the court.
Okay, what I had under new business was I wanted to remind the board that at the April 28th, 2015 special town meeting, Article 12 was passed at the board's request to post agendas and minutes of meetings by our committees and our boards. And I thought enough time had gone by that I took a look at the town website, and I'm only using 2016 figures starting January 1. And I have compiled the results, and we are not living up to the bylaw. And the bylaw also refers to the open meeting law. So we're not doing either.
Could you clarify who? You said we.
Who?
Do you mean the Board of Selectmen or town in general?
The town boards and committees.
It's true that you meant the Board of Selectmen.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Please clarify.
Sorry, Sabrina.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I would like to distribute what I have found and put that item on the July 25th issues, along with the joint meeting of advisory committee and the town accountant's request for year-end transfers. So that'd be three items on July 25th.
Just a note, there was a nearby town, I forget the name of the town, so I won't mention it, but a nearby town here on the South Shore, that a small subcommittee, a capital expenditure subcommittee, held a handful of meetings, six meetings, and they didn't take minutes. And someone wanted the minutes from the 2013 meeting or something like that, and they didn't have them. So they charged us with a violation. Went all the way up to the Attorney General, and she handed them a writ stating that they must reproduce those minutes, either from lost notes, memory, in any way, and they gave them a certain amount of time to reconstruct minutes. So even the smallest subcommittee that may be inconsequential, the Attorney General takes note because it is the state law.
Yeah, well, I just like to add to that. That's very interesting decision by the Attorney General under the open meeting law. But if you recall, we wanted to have this bylaw passed so that this board and the public would be able to go online where we could not attend a meeting. We might be interested in what's going on all of the boards and committees. But a citizen of the town might be only interested in one particular board. They could go online, they could see what the agenda was, they could see what the minutes were, and that's exactly what this board was looking to do. We can't go to the Board of Health meetings, to the conservation meetings, because they're meeting the same time that this board is. So it was a way to keep us informed as to what's going on. So I think it's a simple request to have followed through. Unfortunately, we aren't getting the response. So I think if you see the list, we have a chance to talk about it and see what we can do to get this straightened out. So if there's nothing else to talk about, I would like to tell the public that the next regularly scheduled meeting of the Board of Selectmen is Monday, July 25th at 7 o'clock. And if there's nothing else to bring up, I'll have a motion to adjourn this meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Bill, second by Arthur. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?